I'm Brian. I would like to know if your opinion has ever affected any of your decisions.
Personal.
That's a very good question.
That's a wonderful, great wonderful question. Question.
Sure. Patrice or Carol?
Patrice, you want to do this?
Personal opinion.
I don't think my personal opinion has affected my decisions. We are a result of our experiences, and we see things as a result of our experiences. But we have taken an oath and a promise that we would uphold the law, and that's what we do. And oftentimes, we have to do things that we don't like doing most of the time when it comes to sentencing and different things. But our opinions don't really enter into it, or my opinion.
Carrie met consciously because she said that it's a wonderful, wonderful question. And Chief Judge Tucker said something very important, and that is we are who we are. Most of the time, the law is so clear. As she said, we've taken an oath to uphold it in the law of either a statute, an act of Congress, or a state statute or something. The statute requires a certain result, or a Supreme Court law, or our own court has decided a case so close to this case that the law is clear, and if you don't like it, you hold your nose and you just do it. And that's happened at times. But there are times where the law is ambiguous, and it could be interpreting a statute, or whether or not another case law applies, and it's not really clear what the result should be. In those cases, I personally think, and judges disagree on this, that who you are can have an impact. Most of the time, it's subliminal. You don't know it has that impact. It can, in that case, impact how you decide things.
But you don't decide things because you
right.
have a view.
That's right.
It's just in deciding whether it is difficult, something that, might enter into it based
right.
on your experience.
There are two things that God judges, and that's our oath to be objective and fair and to uphold the law and our experiences. But there's codes of conduct that require us to remove ourselves from deciding a case if we can't put our opinion or our position aside. We must do that. So, and that's a check on us internally. Externally, you could have one of the parties say, Judge, I know how you ruled in another case, and I know that you have a relative that was involved in something similar. Would you please disqualify yourself from hearing this case? It's really up to the judge to decide that. But we have so many decisions, like Judge McKee said, that are close and not all clear, that we are imposing sometimes our discretion. And that's when we really have to be careful about how we rule.
Chief Judge Wells.
I recently had a case in which a young man who was under 18 at the time he was convicted of a crime brought a habeas corpus petition. Most of the magistrate judges handle the habeas corpus. That means, where is the body? When we have a writ of habeas corpus, it's a command to say, bring us the body of that person so we can see if they're lawfully being detained. I held hearings. Some new evidence came forward. That new evidence that was presented made it appear that the person very likely was innocent of the crime. However, the only parameter in which I was allowed to make a decision was whether or not that evidence that he was actually innocent would allow him to bring a late claim, something he should have bought years ago and did not. The law is clear. You must have a separate constitutional claim, such as my attorney didn't do what he should do, someone at trial used language that was not permissible because it was hearsay. They were not in the room. They didn't know what they were talking about. The court should have excluded it. In the end, I wrote in the opinion that I believed he was actually innocent based on the three witnesses who testified, but that I was constrained by the law. That went to Judge McKee and Judge Rendell for a decision. And they affirmed that the statutes in place said that I could not reverse that. The good news, however, the Supreme Court in a recent case called Miller has said you can't give someone a sentence to life in prison without the possibility of parole unless you look at all of the facts and circumstances. So this young man who was under 18 had a second chance and is filing papers now with the state court. So I don't know how his case will end up, but you cannot overstep the bounds of what the statutes and the Constitution tell us to do as judges, or else you become an outlaw. So we do that.